Now, if you are wondering how negotiations can happen without the country under attack, you are not alone. A Ukrainian official told NBC News on the eve of the Vilnius summit, the question arises whether Washington's touch position regarding the invitation of Ukraine to NATO is somehow not connected with these backroom consultations. Joining me now to discuss all this and more, Democratic Congresswoman Sidney Kamlager-Dove. She serves on the House Foreign Affairs Committee. Welcome to you, Congresswoman. Look, wars, they are not actually ended on the battlefield. They are ended at negotiating tables. So what is your response to this exclusive NBC News reporting about these back-channel discussions between former U.S. officials and current Russian officials about Ukraine without Ukraine's input?
Well, first, I want to just say how great it is that we're witnessing a sea change as it relates to foreign policy and the White House. You know, when Trump was in office, he torpedoed our global alliances across the globe. And so Biden seems determined to rebuild and strengthen those alliances by going to NATO. There's a big agenda on his plate, and I hope that he takes extra pairs of big boy and big girl pants with him to hand out to some of our NATO members. The first is making sure that everyone continues to be supportive of Ukraine and the war against Russia and autocracy. I was in Sweden not long ago at a transatlantic legislators dialogue with a delegation from the EU Parliament, and they too are equally supportive of support for Ukraine and also making sure that Sweden sees an ascension into NATO, which is another important topic on that agenda. Russia needs to stop. I mean, we saw with this weird sort of, you know, entry from the Wagner group into Moscow that they are losing the war, the PR war and the actual war. So how do we end this in a way that allows Putin to save face? And how do we help Ukraine rebuild so that they are in a position to then seek an invitation into NATO?
Well, Congresswoman, do you think it is appropriate that former U.S. officials had secret meetings without the knowledge of Ukrainian officials? And at this point, we don't know who in the United States government knew, if anyone, about these meetings with current Russian officials. You know, the foreign affairs minister, Sergei Lavrov, he is no small potato.
No, he's not. What we do know is that conversations happen all the time. You find allies who are like-minded, who want the same outcome, and those folks are generally engaging with folks that they should be engaging with to help us move the needle. And what we know is Russia needs to stop. The war needs to end. We need to see a de-escalation of this retreat so that Ukraine can go ahead and rebuild a very fragile but important democracy that plays a role in global relationships that we have with Europe, with Eastern Europe, with Indo-Pacific, with the United States, with Africa, with Latin America. So, you know, it's not surprising to me that back-channel discussions happen, because that's how you often move the needle and prime people for discussions that are going to happen during the NATO summit.
Indeed. I do think back-channel discussions with former officials without the knowledge of current government officials, though, is quite interesting. I want to talk about the cluster munitions, because you have vocally been opposed to the United States sending these cluster bombs to Ukraine. You heard from President Biden today and the Ukrainian defense minister. What's your response to the assurances that they both laid out?
Well, I don't support the cluster munitions. You know, 10 to 40% of them fail to detonate, and then they're left, and then, you know, they may or may not go off killing innocent civilians. You know, we have made requests about dud rates, about fuse types, about stockpile variants, and we'd like to get that information as it relates to these cluster munitions. I think we haven't been using them since 2016, so it seems like it's almost a garage sale to the Ukraine with very treacherous weaponry. You know, they have made assurances that they are not going to use these in a way that will kill innocent civilians. But what we know is that A, war is unpredictable, and B, audibles happen all the time.
Let's move to the Supreme Court. A Senate Judiciary Chairman, Dick Durbin, has pledged to mark up legislation on Supreme Court reform after the July 4th recess. Let me just remind you what President Biden has said about calls for court expansion. I want to play this for you.
If we start the process of trying to expand the court, we're going to politicize it maybe forever in a way that is not healthy.
That you can't get back.
That you can't get back.
Understanding this is where President Biden is, what would Supreme Court reform legislation need to include to get your vote?
I think we should be looking at expanding the court, and I think we need to have very strong ethics standards. The reports that have been coming out about a couple of the Supreme Court justices are deeply concerning, astounding, and really call into question the legitimacy of this court. So I am in full support. As you know, these recent decisions that have come down, including affirmative action, just really highlight the hypocrisy that is coming out of this court and shows that it is now conservative, activist-minded, and controlled by a small faction of a very extreme Republican Party. And that is not what an impartial Supreme Court is supposed to do or look like.
Folks, Congresswoman Sidney Kamlager-Dove, thank you very much, ma'am, for your time today.